looked and saw a beast coming up from the sea. This one had 10 horns and 7 heads, and a crown was on each of its 10 horns. On each of its heads were names that were an insult to God. The beast that I saw had the body of a leopard, the feet of a bear, and the mouth of a lion. The dragon handed over its own power and throne and great authority to this beast. One of its heads seemed to have been fatally wounded, but now it was well. Everyone on earth marveled at this beast, and they worshipped the dragon who had given its authority to the beast. They also worshipped the beast and said, "No one is like this beast. No one can fight against it." The beast was allowed to brag, claim to be God, and for 42 months it was allowed to rule. The beast cursed God, and it cursed the name of God. It even cursed the place where God lives, as well as everyone who lives in heaven with God. It was allowed to fight against God's people and defeat them. It was also given authority over the people of every tribe, nation, language, and race. The beast was worshipped by everyone whose name wasn't written before the time of creation in the book of the Lamb who was killed. If you have ears, then listen. If you are doomed to be captured, you will be captured. If you are doomed to be killed by a sword, you will be killed by a sword. This means that God's people must learn to endure, be faithful. I saw another beast. This one came out of the ground. It had 2 horns like a lamb, but spoke like a dragon. It worked for the beast whose fatal wound had been healed. And it used all its authority to force the earth and its people to worship that beast. It worked mighty miracles. And while people watched, it even made fire come down from the sky. This second beast fooled people on earth by working miracles for the first one. Then it talked them into making an idol in the form of a beast that did not die after being wounded by a sword. It was allowed to put breath into the idol so that it could speak. Everyone who refused to worship the idol of the beast was put to death. All people were forced to put a mark on their right hand or forehead. Whether they were powerful or weak, rich or poor, free people or slaves, they all had to have this mark, or else they could not buy or sell anything. This mark stood for the name of the beast and for the number of its name. You need wisdom to understand the number of the beast. But if you are smart enough, you can figure this out. Its number is 666, and it stands for a person.
Amen, everybody. That is once again the beast of Revelation. The beast of Revelation, Revelation chapter 13. Well, good evening, everybody. Welcome to the house of our God. You know, I believe that God has really been so very good to us and revealing himself to us through this book. We spoke about the beast of Revelation last week, and we spoke a little bit about it on Sunday also. And I think I'd like to continue the theme for a little bit. As we speak about the beast of Revelation tonight, I really don't want to go verse by verse. Some of you might like to go verse by verse and understand particular aspects of it, but I'd rather just get like the just broad understandings of the beast. Now, if you recall, John the Revelator was on the island of Patmos. He was in prison on this island. And while he was in prison, he says he was on the Lord, it was the Lord's day, and he fell into a trance, if you will. He was meditating, he fell into a trance. And Jesus Christ appeared to him and showed him this great vision. And when Christ appeared to John, he told John to write down the vision, and he did. That's why we're reading it today, because more than 2,000 years ago, John wrote down this vision. And as he was looking, he actually saw these images, and he wrote down the things that he saw. Here in Revelation 13, it says that he saw a beast come up out of the sea. It's interesting because sometimes when you and I see something like this or experience something like this, our first reaction or response would be that of alarm. Like, oh my goodness, there's a beast coming up out of the sea. Oh my goodness, I see a beast. You know, some of us would hide or run, or I don't know, some of you might go fight the beast. But you see, there's a little bit of an alarm. Okay, oh my God, there is a beast. But know this. Know this. When God reveals the beast, you need to understand this. The beast didn't just appear. The beast was always there in your life. It's just at times that God shows you there's a beast in your life. It's not like he suddenly appeared. The beast was always there in the sea. There's a beast that is always laying dormant with inside you and I. I don't think he's so dormant, quite honestly. The beast is always there. And then when we see him, we're afraid. But don't be afraid when you finally see something. Understand that the only reason why God ever reveals something is for the purpose of its destruction. See, that beast has been hiding in your sea, tormenting you more days and more years than you know. The beast has been in full operation, giving you all kinds of pain and sorrow. And then finally, when this beast appear, you know, we want to be afraid. And God says, why? I am showing it. That's the thing that's always been there, always been tormenting you for the purpose of its destruction. The beast out of the sea is not a sad day. It's a good day, everybody. It's a good day. Because now you see what God is about to destroy, the beast. We talked about the beast on Sunday, and who is the beast? The beast is man without God. Right, everybody? We talked about that. The number six is the number of man. It's a mystery, the number of man. Beast is man or woman, humanity, without God. Huh. Now, though, know this. You can never be without God. It's impossible for you to ever be without God. Can I get a witness from somebody? I don't care if you love him or don't think you love him. I don't care if you acknowledge him or say there is no God. Who cares? Your words are empty. God exists and he is in your life. The only thing that is absent is our awareness of him, perhaps our love for him, our worship of him, our pursuit of him. But he is not absent. And I do believe that God wants to reveal the beast. He wants the beast that is in our lives to be exposed. And I think what God is showing you and I as of late is really how much we really live these lives unto ourselves. I think God is showing us just how much of a self-centered, selfish lives that we live, that primarily we live our lives unto ourselves and we give to God what's left over. Sometimes God is not our life, he's just a part of our life when we think of him or whatever. But God is waking up humanity to let us know that the only reason why we live and breathe is for him. There is no other reason in life to live. To live outside of God or without a knowledge of him or pursuit of him is to live an empty life. And I know you don't think that, and I don't think it, because we wouldn't be living our lives if we thought it was empty. We're still chasing everything. We're still chasing what we think we want. You fill in the blank. What are you chasing? What do you want? Did anybody say God? Did I hear God from anybody in the house? yeah, that's right. That's what I was going to say, preacher. God. That's what I want in life. God. I forgot. Case in point, right? You weren't going to say God. This beast is in our life. He destroys us. He brings us sorrow and pain because we think that there is a life. Come on now. We think there is a life outside of God. We think that God wants to take our life from us. I don't want to do that. It's boring. I don't want to do that as if God is boring. as if the breath in your lungs, the life that you have, is boring, empty, not interesting. Right? Please shut them off. Thank you. Okay. Revelation chapter 13. Let's read a verse or two. Brother Mark, you got your microphone? Okay. Let's see. Why don't you read for us? Yeah. Read for us verses 1 and 2.
Then I stood on the sand of the sea, and I saw a beast rising up out of the sea, having 7 heads and 10 horns, and on his horns 10 crowns, and on his head a blasphemous name. Now the beast which I saw was like a leopard. His feet were like the feet of a bear, and his mouth like the mouth of a lion. The dragon gave him his power and his throne and a great authority.
Excellent. Thank you, Brother Mark. Okay, the beast. You know what's interesting? When I saw that video, certain things popped out to me. The scripture says, and we saw in the video, that the beast has power, right? Scripture says the beast has power. How come this beast has so much power? I'll tell you why. Because you are the beast. Because you are the beast. You are the creation of God Almighty. You were made in the image and likeness of God. You have the breath of God inside of you. The beast is so powerful because the beast is you, made by God. That's why we're so powerful, because God made us powerful. We were made in the image and likeness of God. Now, sometimes we don't use our powers for good now, do we? Well, it's like there's nobody here today. Nobody here. Oh, I'm just going to be quiet. Maybe he'll look over my head. Maybe. The reason why the beast is so powerful is because the beast is you. And you are very powerful to do things in your life and do things in other lives and do things in the world. You know that because sometimes you and I attempted to look into the world and see all the destruction. How come there's so much destruction in the world? Because man is powerful. Right? Yeah. That's why we need God in our lives, to have this power channeled in the proper way. Now, this beast was described as different creatures. Does anybody know, or can anybody shout out some of the creatures that this beast was described as? A dragon, yes. A leopard, yes. A bear, one more. And the lion, excellent, very good. Four beasts. You know, this is a really, Revelation 13, it's really drawn from Daniel 7. Daniel saw four beasts rising up out of the earth in the time of Nebuchadnezzar. And the four beasts that Daniel saw were these four beasts. It was a portrayal, or was it a symbol, of the four great nations that were going to arise. And the great nations the great ancient nations, number one was Babylon. Number two was Persia. Number three was Greece. And number four was Rome. You can just read your history books for that one. That one's no mystery, right? So if you have your Bibles, or the gentleman in the back can help us, I want to turn to Daniel chapter 2. You don't have to turn there. We got the notes. I forgot. Okay. On the back of your page, you have the notes here in Daniel's 2. And in Daniel's 2, Daniel was interpreting a dream for Nebuchadnezzar. Nebuchadnezzar had a dream at night, and it bothered him, and he wanted his wise men, remember, to give the interpretation. But he told his wise men, I'm not going to tell you what I dreamed. The only way I can tell if you're going to give me the right interpretation is if you first tell me what I dreamed and then tell me what it means. You guys remember that story? And all the guys told the king it's impossible until Daniel showed up. So Daniel showed up, and he not only saw the dream but interpreted the dream. And before we read the dream, in this dream, Nebuchadnezzar saw the image of a human, the image of a man. And inside this image was all of the four aspects of this beast of Revelation. You can see the leopard and the lion and the bear and the dragon, all contained inside of a person. I want you to know that all of these aspects of the beast reside inside you and me, reside inside a person. A lion lives in you, and a leopard lives in you, and a bear and a dragon lives in you. And all of these beasts that partake of our lives are ways that we live our life without God. in a certain way. So let us read our passage and maybe just use Daniel 2 for our text tonight. In verse 31, I'll read it. In verse 31, it says, "You, O king," this is Daniel now explaining the dream, "you, O king, were watching and behold a great image. This image was this image whose splendor was excellent stood before you, and its form was awesome." Of course it was. It was the form of a human being. Of course. We're made in the image and likeness of God. Remember, the beast is powerful. It's you. This image's head was of fine gold, its chest and arms of silver, its belly and thighs of bronze, its legs of iron, its feet partly of iron and partly of clay. Then you watched while a stone was cut out without hands and struck the image on its feet of iron and clay and broke them in pieces. Then the iron, the clay, the bronze, the silver, and the gold were crushed together and became like chaff from the summer threshing floor. The wind carried them away so that no trace of them was found. And the stone that struck the image became a great mountain and filled the whole earth. This is the dream, Daniel tells him. Now, we will tell you the interpretation. And he goes on in verse 37, he says, "You, King Nebuchadnezzar, are the King of Kings. For the God of heaven has given you a kingdom, power, strength, and glory. And wherever the children of men dwell, or the beasts of the field and the birds of heaven, he has given them into your hand and has made you ruler of them all. You are the head of gold." Pause. King Nebuchadnezzar, he was the first part of this image. He was the king of, you remember what nation he was the king of? Babylon. Perhaps his kingdom was the greatest. His kingdom was in operation for almost 100 years. He conquered all the lands around him, King Nebuchadnezzar. But he was conquered, wasn't he? He was conquered. You know who conquered him? You are correct, the Persians. So next we have the Persians, right? Verse 39. "But after you shall arise another kingdom inferior to yours." The Persians were inferior to the Babylonians. "Then another, a third kingdom of bronze," which is the Greeks, "which shall rule over all the earth." Anybody know the leader of the Greeks? Alexander the Great. Verse 40. "And the fourth kingdom shall be as strong as iron." Anybody know the fourth kingdom? Rome. Rome ruled the world. "The fourth kingdom shall be as strong as iron, inasmuch as iron breaks in pieces and shatters everything like iron that crushes. That kingdom will break in pieces and crush all others. Whereas you saw the feet and the toes partly of potter's clay and partly of iron, the kingdom shall be divided. Yet the strength of iron shall be in it, just as you saw the iron mixed with the ceramic clay." Okay, after Rome fell, Rome broke up into 10 small nations, okay? And that's what it's speaking of here. Rome fell and broke up into 10 nations. It goes on and it says, "As you saw iron mixed with clay, they mingled the seed of men, but they will not adhere to one another, just as iron does not mix with clay. And in the days of these kings, the God of heaven will set up a kingdom," because that's when Jesus was born, remember? Jesus was now born, and the kingdom of heaven came upon the earth during the Roman Empire, "which shall never be destroyed. And the kingdom shall not be left to other people. It shall break in pieces and consume all kingdoms, and shall stand forever. Inasmuch as you saw the stone was cut out of the mountain without hands, and that it broke in pieces the iron, the bronze, the clay, the silver, and the gold. The great God has made known to the king what will come to pass. The dream is certain, and its interpretation is true. The word of the Lord, everybody. This is a dream that will come true in your life, in my life. Because this image that Nebuchadnezzar saw, if you will, it's an image of every individual. It's an image of you. It's an image of me. You are the one that has the head of gold and the chest and the arms of silver and the midsection of bronze and the legs of iron. It's you. It's you. It's the image of a person, of a human, of a man. It's you. And God knows that through the course of your life, there are going to be many things that rule your life, but ultimately God will rule your life. Ultimately God will rule your life. But you go through phases. You go through phases and you live your life as a beast, because there's many times when God does not rule our lives. Other things rule our life. And I want to talk about the first one. The first one, if you remember, was Babylon, right? He was the head of gold. And us living as a beast or without God, that and an aspect here with Babylon, to have the head of gold, it's us to live our lives out of our own minds. It's for our minds to rule our lives and for our intellects to rule our life. Sometimes it is our minds that rule our lives and not God Almighty. You know what is so interesting? The power of your minds. Isn't it true just how powerful a human being's mind is? Your mind can make your body do things that are absolutely impossible. Have you heard stories or have you done them yourself? Your mind will make you believe things that are true that are absolutely not true. Have you ever experienced one of them? Your mind is so powerful. Why is this beast of revelation so powerful? Because it's you. It's you. And sometimes we live our lives from our mind, from our reasoning, and not necessarily from the Spirit of God. We cause our intellect and our reason to make our decisions in life rather than God Almighty, who lives right in the very center of you. There's a time in your life when your mind rules your life, your intellect rules your life, your reasoning rules your life, until you get a taste of God and you start to figure out. You start to figure out that you really live your life from your heart and you don't respond to your mind. There's a gut instinct inside of you. There's a spirit of God inside you that tells you what to do and when to do it. Have you ever lived from that place? Come on now. God is teaching us. He's exposing the beast to destroy the beast, to tell us not to live. And the mind is not supposed to rule our lives. Sound reasoning is not supposed to rule our lives. I think our reasoning rules our lives. Part of our reasoning is us planning our budgets and making our money and planning our futures. I'm sorry. It's not really very godly. It really isn't. Because we will throw God away because we are pursuing all of that garbage. And God only gets what's left over. Your mind rules your life because your mind tells you you have to do this and you have to do this. It's just smart. It's common sense. It's got to be done. Maybe your mind is wrong. Maybe your mind is wrong. Maybe you're supposed to live from your heart and your spirit. Maybe you're supposed to stop loving money. Oh, I don't love money, preacher. I just need it. Okay, excuse me, but you're all liars. I don't love it. I just need it. Liar. I can say that to you because I said that to myself before I came up here. I said, Mike, stop loving money. Do not love money. Don't look at it. Don't want it. Don't desire it. I'm speaking to every human being. Are you a human being? Okay, the seven of you who are human beings, I am talking to you tonight. I know we make it godly and religious and necessary and responsible. You love money. And your life is primarily, how do I get money? Money, money, money. I need my money. We will throw faith and God and everything away. Because money first. Money first. And I believe this is an aspect where your mind rules your life. And God, you are a beast without God when God does not rule. So this kingdom has to fall. Can I get an amen, please? Jesus, help me. Yeah, you can only do this with God's help. You can only do this, and I pray that God help us tonight. There's such a pitfall to this. I have to pause. There is a pitfall when you love money. There's a pitfall when you want money. There's a pitfall to it. The pitfall is you prostitute yourself, if you will, of truth and righteousness, of what's right to do and what's real, because you need the money. Would anybody agree with me, or you just want to look at me like I'm crazy? I know it's true because I do it. I do it. I prostitute myself for money. I think that money is more important than my relationship with this person. Just give me the money. Just give me the money. Okay, got the money. Okay. Money is not our goal. People, relationships, doing good and doing right. I believe this is part of the beast that God wants to destroy in your life. I believe God wants to tell you, stop counting it, stop looking at it, stop wanting it, stop desiring it, stop being happy because you have it. My goodness, you love money more than you love God. That should be our attitude towards God, wanting it, desiring it, counting it. Can't wait till I get more of it. Hey, I got to get some more God, man. I don't got time for you, man. I got to get more God. I need more God. My life will end without God. Yeah, amen. That's right. Amen, 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 amen. I never hear that out of our mouths. What happened to the amens? Give me one more. Come on, give me one more. Amen. Okay, now we can move on. Where's your faith? Money? I'm sorry, I wasn't finished. My goodness, it's so empty and corruptible. Only a beast lives for money. Only a beast lives for money. Okay, moving on. Number two. Does anybody remember the second one? No, that one's going to stick in my head for like a week. I'm not even going to look at the dollars on my account. I won't look at it. I won't look at it. I'll take it, put it in my pocket, but I won't look at it. Okay. The second empire is the Persian Empire, but as you see in Revelation and as you see in Daniel, it's typified as the bear. The bear. And the bear is known, quite honestly, for its strength. Sometimes, you know, we live our lives by our strengths. And when we live our lives from our strengths, we become quite self-reliant, where we don't have a need for God and each other, because I'm strong enough. And I'm sure some of you in all of your strength have said something like I've said, I don't need help from nobody. I got this. Are there any Persian bears in the house? Persian bear? What? You call me a Persian bear? What? I don't need your help. I'll tell you what, I don't need your stinking help. How about that? I don't need your stinking help. I'll do this all by myself. I don't need nobody for nothing. You're a beast. How dare you? The beast says that. The beast says, I don't need anybody. I can do it. I got it. Nah, forget you. Forget you. I got this. You're a beast. The beast lives from its own strength without realizing you need everybody. You need people. You need people to live. You need God. You need those people around you who irritate you. Yes, you need them. Right? God will expose the beast in order to destroy the beast. The beast is the person who lives from their own strength. Ain't God. Thank God that this kingdom will also fall. You know what's interesting about this beast? This beast is the Persian Empire. You know, some of you who know your history or are intrigued by history, you know that the Persian King Artaxerxes was the only one to assemble, history says, the million-man army. And those of you who would know about the million-man army, he was going to rule and conquer the world through his strength. So he built a bridge across a body of water by putting a whole bunch of boats together. It was like a little narrow pass, maybe, I don't know, a few miles or so. from Turkey to Greece, you know. And he built a bridge out of boats, and he had his million-man army go across these boats and invade Greece. And some of you know history, you know that this million-man army was confronted by 300 Greeks. Anybody ever see the movie or read the book, The 300? The Battle of Thermopylae. 300 Greeks destroyed the million-man army. 300 Greeks destroyed the million-man army. You know, Greece was the next great empire. Your strength is nothing. You have nothing. You don't. Your strength is this compared to God in your life.
That's right. Amen.
Almighty, all-powerful God. He wants to rule your life. He is more powerful than you. Why don't you just let go and let God?
Right.
He's the real power. You got no power. You got strength. You got no strength. Anybody? Come on, man. You ain't got nothing. You ain't strong. You're not strong. He's strong. Why do we chase anything else? Why do we live this life as if there's something else to live for? Why are we so deceived? Why are we so deceived? See, the beast is hidden in the sea. Let the beast be exposed. God is everything. The only reason why we live is because God created us, and then we go live our lives as if there's something to live for. Anybody in the house? Okay, this Persian Empire, our strength will fail us. Our strength will fail us. He'll cause your strength to fail you. But then there's another aspect of this beast nature. Does anybody know the third one? Well, we just talked about it. Say it again. It's Greece. Yeah, you are correct. Whoever said that, you are correct. Greece. And Greece is represented by the leopard. You know the interesting about Greece. Greece is the midsection, and therefore I see Greece as our emotions, our passions, our desires. Because sometimes what rules your life are your desires, your passions. Sometimes just your emotions, man. Your emotions rule your life, and I could rattle them off. I mean, pride, anger, you know, depression. How you're happy and sad, you know. But I think more is our passions rule our life, or maybe passions doesn't help define it. We're ruled by our desires, because everybody has a certain desire, you know. And I'm not saying that they're all pure. Some of us have some desires that we just can't get out of our lives, you know. And our lives are ruled by our desires. I gotta have you fill in the blank. Yeah, write it on your piece of paper. I gotta have you. Go ahead, write it on your piece of paper. Your papers forward. I'm going to burn them in the fire tonight. And this applies to me, and it applies to you, and applies to every human being that lives. Our lives are dominated by our desires. We will throw family away and good sense away because I have to have this one thing. Is anybody going to agree with me tonight? This is the beast nature, but God wants to destroy the beast in you.
Amen.
Where your desires do not rule your life. Isn't that amazing? You know what amazes me? Maybe the same thing amazes you. Like sometimes I can feel so godly and powerful and holy, you know? But in a blink, all of a sudden, I just have a certain desire for something. And it's like, I will throw God right out the window. I see you later, Jesus. I got to get what I got to get. I'll get with you in 5 or 10, or I don't know however long it takes you to do what you do. I'll be back. I mean, am I the only one that happens to? I'm just curious.
No.
Glad you're here tonight, Chad. Because everyone else is like, Man, I could be singing the praises of Jesus, feeling so powerful, man, feeling very holy. And all of a sudden, something comes over me. It's like, I got to go do something. Revelation 13 said the beast is powerful. Is the beast powerful?
Yes.
Beast is powerful. All of a sudden, all you holy people are doing things that you know you don't want to do anymore. There's no condemnation here because we're all the same here, right? Every human being is the same. There's not someone who breathes was different. Right? That's why we need the beast to be destroyed. In every aspect, we got to stop living for ourselves. Why are we running after our empty lives that's full of all this? If we run after God, if we realize God
Add God to the equation. Add 1 to the 6, it becomes the 7, right? Just add God. Does the beast dominate your life? Add God. What's the answer?
More God. You need more God.
Amen.
Not less God. More God. I'm going to talk to you while I got your attention because I know I don't have it long. Some of you are still back on that desire thing. Wait, what time is he going to end here? Right. You just put a thought in my head. This beast in Revelation that looks like the leopard, as you and I, living according to our desires. What's the answer? Stop living for ourselves. Throw everything away. When you're actually able to, I think God will help you more and more, but let us realize that the only life to live is a life of God. Everything else is a life to self, and it's full of destruction. I know when I was a younger man, there were certain things I wanted in life, and I wanted to live my life, and I thought that God was taking my life away. Has anyone ever thought like that? I wonder. Zero hands in the house. God's life, man, if you could pay for it, you wouldn't have enough money to pay for it. The life of God. We'll take it. Full of glory and power. Faith and security and confidence and on and on. Amen, everybody?
Amen.
Why are we such beasts following and chasing such ugly, insignificant things? Okay, after Greece, there was another empire that finally rose up. What's the fourth one, guys? Rome, you got it. And Rome is seen as the dragon, if you will. And the interesting thing, you know what I was thinking? Rome is seen as the iron legs. And I said, well, what's the iron legs? And God said very quickly, it's your iron will. That's what Rome is, when you live from your own will. You know, maybe it's better defined as your stubborn will. What you want, you're going to live your life as you want to live your life, I will. I think we read that on Sunday. There were how many I wills? I will exalt my throne above the heavens. I will make myself like the Most High. I will, I will, I will. It's our stubborn wills. Until we say the words, Father, not my will, but thy will be done.
Amen.
But until that's our essence, is there any other will? You know, there's the great debate in philosophy and theology, you know, what we created with free will. Yeah, okay. First of all, free will isn't written once in the Bible. Already, you know my position. I gave it away. Huh? What we created with free will. There's one will. One mind. It's his will. Anything outside of his will is the beast nature. You're living unto yourself. But why else would you want to live? Why would you want to live a lesser life? You know, may that become the absolute essence of our being, that we're constantly aware of God in our lives. It doesn't mean you're not going to have family and you're not going to have jobs and you're not going to do what you still do. I bet you the physical aspects of your day will change, but will not change. But life it will absolutely change for you. I cannot tell you how beautiful and how powerful and how freeing it is to live for nothing but God. You live for God. All in a moment, your life is taken out of the hands of man. But nobody controls you. Nobody has power over you except God. And if you and God are all right, everything is all right. Nobody has power in your life. Because in that way, all you need is God. God will use people to bless you, but you're not looking to grab and get this, and then it's mostly back to that money thing. What money am I need? God. If we understood God, we would be so free. If we understood God, if we understood the life that we have in God, and that we lived our lives for his will and for his glory.
and know that he's already involved in everything you do. All of your business and all of your family, he's already put you in your business and put you in your family to bless everybody around you, you know? You're not there to get the blessing. Oh, I'm going to get a blessing. No, you are there to bless somebody. He wants you to start your business to bless somebody, not to make you rich. You will be rich when you touch the hearts and lives of people, when you set people free, when you take away their pain and their sorrow. Then you'll be rich. Take your money and throw it in the fire. That's not why you have business. You have business to heal people, to help people. You go to work to help people, to love people. You're in your families for that reason. It's God, not my will, but thy will be done. If we only, by the grace and help of God, would not live like a beast upon this earth, but live made in the image and likeness of God, we would live our lives entirely different, doing the same motions, but entirely different. Can I get a witness from one more person? Okay, that's good. I believe it to be true. Now, let me end with this, because it says this. It says that the feet were mixed. You remember what it says about the feet? It was iron and clay, right? Iron and clay. And it said the iron and clay didn't mix, and that's why the thing fell down. You see, all of these things that you live unto and live for and these things that rule our lives, they will fail. Ultimately, this beast in your life and my life will be destroyed. Thank you, Jesus. He's going to destroy it. And the reason why it's going to be destroyed is because you can't mix clay and iron. That's what Daniel said, right? You can't mix clay and iron. Who's the clay? You're the clay. You know where you first see clay in the Bible? Genesis. You're made out of clay. The only thing you can mix clay with is God. God breathed the breath of life inside the clay, and all of a sudden, poof, it became you and all your awesomeness. You can't mix clay with iron and gold and silver. You can't mix your humanity with your minds, with your strengths, with your desires. You can only take your beautiful humanity and mix it with the Spirit of God Almighty, and that mix will come and adhere, and you will rule the world that way. How about ruling this world that way? It will cause all of the other kingdoms in your life to topple. You cannot mix clay with your mind, with your strength, with your money. You cannot mix it with your desires. The only thing you can mix clay with is God. Amen. The only one thing that humanity needs, humanity does not need anything in life. If you mix it with anything in life, it will crumble and fall. I don't know what you're looking for, but if it ain't God, it's going to crumble and fall. There's only one thing you're supposed to do with your humanity, and mix it with God. And then you will see this great, huge mountain that fills the whole earth. Then you're going to see a kingdom that will last forever and ever and ever. It is the kingdom of God. I pray that God will expose the beast in our life. I pray that we would see that we are the beast. I pray that God would show us just how much we live unto ourselves. I pray that we would understand the power and the glory of living for God. That anything else is a lie, and we've been lied to by ourselves for how long? How long? I say, how long? Yeah. All right. May God set us all free. Pastor, Dad, why don't you close with some words of wisdom? Why don't you all stand, everybody?
He gave more than enough wisdom tonight.
Oh, the aged will speak.
Praise God. Did you hear anything tonight?
Those who have ears to hear,
praise God. With the mic, you'll hear better. But Pastor Mike, I have to say you have a dynamic teacher here. I know the man. I know the man. I'm not talking about the physical man. And the words he gives are powerful, and they're accurate. And Revelation is not a horror book. The more I've been reading lately, in fact, I've been reading Revelation more lately than I have in my entire life, because that's what Pastor Mike does. He gets you intrigued. And we need to be intrigued with the word. But what's there is powerful, and it's all good. I want to make an emphasis on all good. Oh, my goodness, the beast. The beast, the beast. That is so accurate, Pastor Mike. That is so accurate. The first time I read it in Scripture, I was startled. And it wasn't in Revelation either. It was in Psalms. And it caught me. I was set back, and I said, whoa. And David said, when I was a brute beast, thou art with me. So what you said is, he's always with us. Even when I act like a wild beast, because he loves us more than we can ever possibly know yet here on this earth. We're growing more and more. But there's so much, the clay, the iron and the clay, a mixture. God hates mixture. There's so much there. So it's all good. It's all powerful. We need to see. I've said that before, but I know that's the imperative thing when you're reading, when you're hearing, is to see. Because when you see, it'll be clear. And so God wants things to be clear to us. There's no fog. There's no deception. In fact, Revelation, it talks about, the titles of things are revealing. The curtains pull back. He wants you to see. Pass the mic, you keep clearing the way. So I think I can't stop thinking fast enough and writing fast enough because there's so much there. So I pray that you're intrigued. You're drawn in. Because God wants to draw us in beyond the curtain, beyond the veil, beyond the things that are, you know, obscure. There's nothing obscure about God. So Pastor Mike is powerful tonight. There's much been revealed. So I pray you'll lay hold of what Pastor Mike has revealed through the Word by the Spirit. Because it's all by the Spirit. Father, just give you praise and thanks, my Lord. As you continue to open the eyes of our heart, our spirit, Lord, that we shall see, because you shall pull back the veil that we put up. Not you, we do. So, Lord, help us to see the beauty, the power of your love, your care for us. My Lord, it is all good. In fact, in Genesis, you said it's very good. So we thank you, Lord, for all that you are doing, for it is very good. And we give you praise in Jesus' name. And amen. And amen.